Okay, so question one is from Suzanne Deramond. Hello, Fordabella. Thought I would submit a question for the Q&A. I've been experimenting with water pouring shibuichi, and I wonder if Ford would share some tips. Namely, I'm wondering what you pour it onto to get such nice lens-shaped bean guts. Thank you for the info you share. I'm enjoying it and learning a lot.
Okay. Shibuichi is a tricky metal. It's a good generic alloy would be 80% copper, 20% silver. Well, the first thing to note is that the silver must go into the melt after the copper has been fully melted. And then what you do is you throw the copper in, the silver in, and you wait. It's a matter of intuition. So you've got to try and catch the moment when the silver has completely melted, but hasn't had time to stew as such. You don't want the silver to completely break down into its smallest particles. What you want is the silver to have diffused, but still are discrete, that is to say you can see them when it's properly polished, particles of silver surrounded by copper. So it's a bit like a fine stone wall effect. To do this, you've got to catch it at the right moment. So it's literally a matter of melting the copper, getting the silver in, and then trying to judge how quickly it would take. You have to imagine how quickly the silver would completely melt, like ice in warm water, into the copper. Bearing in mind, you don't have to stir it because the molecules and are bouncing around in there so fast because there's so much energy and heat that the silver will mix through anyway. You can, as you take the crucible out of the furnace, give it a slight stir. Just within, you know, hold the cup and just stir it so the liquid will swirl around. What you must also do is when you're melting copper is cover the liquid copper or the copper as you put it in the crucible with some charcoal pieces. I usually pieces about the size of my thumb. This is really important because copper in a liquid state, just like fine silver, will absorb up to 100% its own volume in oxygen. This will render it into a spongy mass, which is useless. So it's really important to keep the oxygen away. That's what the charcoal on top will do. And if you're pouring into water, of course, the charcoal just floats away. And that's, of course, why it's useful to have a Chinese stir fry scoop. Which got stolen from the kitchen, and a chicken was stolen from a chicken. Now that doesn't even make sense. Stolen from the kitchen. If you have a Chinese grandmother, don't steal it. She will chop you up. I don't have a Chinese grandmother, by the way. I do have a Taiwanese student in the class here today. Hi, Ching.
Hi.
And so what do we call this in Chinese? I don't think she's really Taiwanese. She's faking it. Yeah, but what's the name?
Dumplings.
It's a dumpling scoop, apparently. There you go. But it's useful for getting charcoal out of the pot. So that's a special Asian implement. It's authentically Asian for taking things out. It's handy. Anyway, moving on. So yes, you've got to keep the oxygen out. That's really important. Another thing with Shakudo and Shibuichi alloys that hasn't really been addressed is the oxides can form on the surface of the copper. Copper oxides, cuprite, those tiny little red spots you sometimes see on the metal after you've soldered it, that can be reabsorbed into the copper. That's going to cause you problems. One, it may cause fractures when forging, or when you patinate, when you've polished the metal and patinate, you may get little specks of cuprite within the metal. That is something that has to be avoided. So the charcoal does limit that also. That's pretty important. As for what I pour into, I use a reasonable heavyweight cotton, what they call canvas duck. It's a bit heavier than denim jeans, really, but you don't want anything synthetic at all. Just a good cotton canvas is ideal. And what I do is, in this case, I used an old pan ground off the bottom. So it's a ring of metal. You could use any metal support. You could use wood, I suppose. And I've got the canvas supported in the center. I've just wired it very crudely around the outside. And that's it's just that. And I then will put that inside a big frying pan, also stolen from the kitchen. So it sits in there. And then it's covered with water. You can see the line. It's about an inch from the top. So I've got about 7 centimeters of water on the top of the canvas. That's the ideal depth you want. So I think it's about 3 inches or seven centimeters, water to the canvas. What you find is when you put the water in and you bring this to the boil, because this needs to be at least 70 degrees centigrade. I don't know what that is in Fahrenheit. You can Google it, apparently. You need the water at 70 degrees at least, because you're pouring molten metal into water. If you pour molten metal into cold water, generally speaking, that's a really, really, really bad idea. It tends to split and explode, which can cause loss of eyebrows. Don't ask me how I know. So you want the water in there at a good temperature, 70 degrees, I say, is the minimum, and 7 centimeters of water depth. And this is the heavy canvas cloth that I tend to use. I think that's the tips I would give for melting and pouring shibuichi. The ingots I tend to pour are about 220 grams. That's more than enough for your average suba. It also means that you can forge it more readily. I will talk about forging in another film later on.